on board. I hope you are too. Happy Christmas, everyone. Had a moment of joy with all the craziness going on around you. And if you just want to snuggle up and not talk about Christmas, I completely get that too. Coming up on the show, Maddie Mote will be joining me, kids TV presenter, and just she's full of energy and delight. She really is. She's got a brand new book out called A Curious Christmas. She's also in panto, so we'll be talking about that. Oh no, we won't. Oh yes, we will. Anthea Turner and her sister Wendy Turner have another book out. We're going to be talking to them about that. Let Loose, the band, they're back together again. They're gigging. They got a single out. They're going to be playing live on the show. Andrew McLean and Nick Feeney, they've got a new podcast out, Mastering Midlife. And they'll be live in the studio. Kim Wade-Tavares has a film out, The Kitchen, which he directed with Daniel Kaluuya. So we're going to be chatting about that. Josh Dillon and Sir Lenny Henry on the show too. Go nowhere. They're going to be live on the show. This was their biggest single from the 90s. The boys are back together with a little change. They will be explaining all, and they're going to be performing live in the studio. So we thought, why not? Let's start the show with this. Crazy for You, Let Loose. Hi, everyone.
Thank you.
and let loose. The 90s boy band, they are back and they're going to be live in the studio in the second hour. So that's between 1 and 2, and they're going to be playing live. And hopefully we'll be hearing their brand new single as well, If the World Was Ending. Ooh, that sounds a little bit alarming. We'll find out more when they're on the show. Also, don't forget, Josh Dillon will be on the show. He of the Buccaneers, Masters of Air. He's enormous. My elder daughter is very jealous. I'm going to be chatting to him. So he's going to be on the show. And also Sir Lenny Henry will be talking about his brand new children's book. And talking of children's books, Anthea Turner and Wendy Turner are also going to be talking about their books, as is Maddie Moat. Delighted to welcome Maggie back to the show. How are you, Maddie?
Hello, I'm all right, thank you. How are you doing?
I'm really well, thank you, Maddie. You've got a book out as well, and I love all the crafting that you do. You're just joyful, a very curious Christmas. Tell us more, please, Maddie.
Oh, thank you. So basically, it was a couple of years ago, I went looking for a book that, you know, might sort of talk about the science of Christmas, give them some ideas for seasonal experiments, and I couldn't find one anywhere. So I just thought, you know what, maybe that would be a really fun book to write. And it sort of started off as just looking at the science of winter and Christmassy things, you know, asking questions like, why do Christmas bang? But actually, I ended up sort of researching and delving into a whole lot more. And the book now is a whole collection of stories explaining, you know, the reasons behind some of our favourite Christmas traditions as well. And I just had a brilliant time writing it.
I can imagine. But OK, so what was the thing that surprised you most?
Oh, what surprised me most? Oh, OK. I mean, I was quite... Well, I did a little bit of research into turkeys. As in, you know, why do we have turkey at Christmas?
Run, turkey, run! Run, turkey, run! Yes. Tell us about turkeys.
I discovered that actually, sort of back in the medieval times, actually people were more likely, well, wealthier people would have had a medieval boar's head. They'd have pickled the head of a boar and stuffed it with all sorts
run,
of things.
Run, sorry, yes, carry on.
Then we sort of started eating goose. But it wasn't until much later in the Victorian times when turkeys sort of came over. But actually, all of the farms, the turkey farms, were over in the east of England, and they had to get them to London. So for about 3 months before Christmas, turkey farmers would march 200,000 turkeys from Norfolk to London by foot.
No!
So you just had parades of turkeys going across the UK to get to the London markets where they'd be sold to people who could afford them. So that surprised me.
Corral them?
Just with people, just as you would do sheep, I suppose. But what's actually a little bit sad is that they would put little rubber boots on the turkey's feet to protect them because they had to walk such a long way.
Oh, Maddie.
I know.
No,
but
you see.
Many joyful things. Oh, go on.
How can you eat a turkey after it's walked all that way? You've got to congratulate it and celebrate the turkey.
And give it a little medal.
Yes. And what do they do with all the little boots?
I have absolutely no idea. I didn't look into that one that much, to be honest.
Can you, for your next book, find out what happened to the boots, if you could?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, what else did I learn? Oh, gosh, Christmas crackers. That's something that's very British. Like, actually, there aren't many other countries in the world that have Christmas crackers, but we do have them here. And it's a huge part of our Christmas dinners. And I discovered that they were actually created by a chap called Tom Smith. And Tom Smith crackers, they still make crackers today. But he originally owned a sweet shop. And he had these sweets that he put little love messages inside that were inspired by these like sugared almonds that he saw in Paris. But he had this idea when he was sat by a crackling fire that maybe he could make his sweets a bit more exciting. So he went to a firework company and they made him these little snaps, and he put these snaps inside the sweets and he called them bangs of expectation. And they were the first Christmas crackers.
No!
Yeah, isn't that cute?
Oh, Maddie, that is fantastic. Okay, now you've given us two, and always, as you know, in television and radio, it has to be the best of three. So now you have to give us a third one.
Oh, okay. Wow, let me think.
Everyone's going to want to buy this book. It's fantastic.
Do you have a favourite Christmas tradition? Maybe I could give you a little tidbit on something that you love doing around Christmas.
Well, do you know what I really, really, really love? Apart from the Brussels sprouts, which are my favourite, I know it's that's my favourite. But I love putting fairy lights everywhere.
Yeah, I love fairy lights too. I think actually I looked a little bit into just decorating Christmas trees in general. It was really hard to sort of discover like the origins of a Christmas tree, because it's something that people all over the world, lots of different cultures have done around the time, around winter time. And actually one of the main inspirations for Christmas trees dates back to a Roman festival called Saturnalia, which is when the Romans celebrated the god of Saturn. And they believed that Saturn was the god of farming. So they like to celebrate Saturn around sort of midwinter, because they were hoping that if they celebrated him then, he would then give them a good crop for the spring that would be coming. But because most of the trees had died back, instead they would bring evergreen trees to decorate their homes. So that's one of the reasons why we bring evergreen trees into our homes now, because of Saturn and a Roman festival.
You know everything, Maddie. You're a Christmas fairy.
I had so much fun researching. There was so much I learned that I didn't expect in researching Christmas. It was great. I went down so many little rabbit holes.
Oh, how fantastic. So this is A Very very Curious Christmas by Maddie Mote. It's out now. Perfect Christmas present. Absolutely perfect. But actually for all the family, because it's for everybody. It's not just a kids thing. Obviously, people know you from kids telly. But you just, your Instagram is lovely. I was having a look at it as well. And you're on YouTube and you just do so. Your make and do's are fabulous. You know, you and Stacey Solomon should do a show together. You really should.
Hook me up with Stacey. I love her.
I love Stacey. So tell us about Panto. Are you in Panto again this year?
I am. I'm actually hiding in the corner of a theatre right now. So if you can hear a bunch of performers warming up in the background, that's what that is. They're warming up their voices. I'm currently doing, I'm playing Tinkerbell in the all-new adventures of Peter Pan and at the Auburn Arena in St Albans. And yeah, I'm loving it. I'm flying through the window up to 3 times a day at the moment and taking someone off to Neverland, and it's brilliant fun.
Are you actually flying?
I am. I do. I get to fly. It's so exciting. It's the way I start the show. I have to fly in. So it's so nerve-wracking just hanging
off stage. No, you don't. You fly. You don't hang.
Oh, of course. Well, we all know it's fairy dust, obviously.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Oh, I think that's the perfect role for you. Absolutely wonderful. Are you singing any songs in it?
I am.
Come on.
When I first found out, I was just like, oh my goodness me. But you know, Spaceman by Sam Ryder.
Can we have a little bit of it, please? Come on.
I would do now, but I have not warmed up and I would not want to do that to your listeners.
Oh, Maddie. We're so... Just one line.
Oh, I can give you the lyrics. What is it? I think I start by saying, if I were a fairy and were floating in midair, all your problems in this orphanage would all be left down there.
Oh, that's fantastic.
And then we're off to Spaceman to find Peter Pan. Oh,
I hear he's a spaceman. Oh, listen, break a leg, but not literally, but break a leg. Have a fantastic time in Panto. Have a very, very happy Christmas and a very curious Christmas. Maddie Mote's brand new book is out now. A real pleasure speaking to you. And I hope you do have a lovely Christmas.
Oh, so nice chatting. Have a nice day, Gabby. Bye.
Some problems, and no one could seem to solve them. But you found the answer. You told me to take this chance and learn the ways of love, my baby, and all that it has to offer. In time, you will see.
know, Khan, you sound like somebody else and I can't work out who it is. But you, I love that voice. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Now, I've been practising. Na dolly chlawen.
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 That's it?
Perfect. Is that it?
Perfect. And na dolly chlawen to you as well, Gabby.
And that means Happy Christmas in Welsh.
It does indeed.
Do you know, I think the Welsh language, and I know I've said this before, Sioned William, that I've said this before to you, but it's such a beautiful sing-songy language.
Well, it's interesting. It sounds, once you listen to other languages as well, you realise that it's quite similar in sound to something like Swedish. We make a lot of the same sounds as the Swedes, particularly North Wales. The Swedes make a ooh sound, and so do North Walians.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but it also sounds a bit like Hebrew because it's got lots of ch's in it and ths. And yeah, it's interesting. It's
so can you say we wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year, please.
Nadolig llawen a blwyddyn newydd dda.
Oh, isn't it beautiful? Sounds lovely. Thank you very much indeed. Okay, so you're here to talk about television. We have to obviously talk about last night's final. I loved every moment.
Yeah.
I actually, even though I wanted Bobby to win, and his dance for his mother had me in tears. His La La Land was spectacular. That made me cry. I think the right person won.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the thing about Strictly is that it's so many different things, isn't it? It's extraordinary journeys, as they say. Well, it's the most uplifting, joyful, inclusive, fantastically made show on television. It's
yes, it
brilliantly
is.
Shot. It's brilliantly created. Every detail is perfect, from the extraordinary technical effects, the makeup, the costumes, the singing, Dave Arch and his band, all those singers who just sing so many different genres of song. And then you get so many different kinds of dancer. So you get people like Krishnan and Angela Rippon, who actually were both terrific, but were there because they were having a damn good time.
Yeah.
You know, they didn't really expect to win, but they enjoyed the journey, you know. Then you get someone like Ellie, who goes from having a little bit of dance training, I understand.
But she wasn't a trained dancer. Yeah.
But you know, there's this miracle of her becoming a great professional dancer. And then you get someone like Leighton, who had some dance training, ballroom.
No, but he was a dancer.
He was, which is why, of course, he is quite an extraordinary thing to watch. But I like the fact that there is one dance every week that you know is going to be a really remarkable piece of dancing. Because the other joy of Strictly, I think people sometimes lose sight of this, is that it's about great dancing as well.
Yes.
And you have these extraordinary pros who are fantastically gifted dancers, all of them.
Their routine yesterday, and Amy
back, wasn't that just so moving?
Made me cry. I mean, everything about it made me cry. And then with the two guys, and then both in tears.
I know, I think Nikita has given an absolute sort of revolution in this, because he's been given a kind of license to be somebody slightly different. Nikita,
I've never been a big fan, but what a generous
performer.
Oh.
But also, you know, he's been able to dance incredibly complex dances. So you know, it's great. You've got a bit of everything. I think Ellie was the right winner because she went from one thing to another, and that's part of it. But Leighton is also a truly great dancer who I hope will carry on dancing. And Bobby, and all three great role models. You know, Leighton saying, use your difference as a superpower.
Fabulous.
There are a lot of people at home who will think about that and think, okay, I'm entitled to be me. And that's such an important thing.
Very.
I mean, this show is worth the license fee alone, simply because of the resources, the use of television, and the joy it brings to people. And that montage at the end of the viewers, that was them saying, we know we're nothing without you. And that was profoundly moving. All those people engaging in this joyful thing.
I agree.
You know?
And it has people that knock that show, and I wish they wouldn't, because I think it's very precious, actually. And I don't. And everyone says, oh, it's time for a revamp. No,
I don't agree at all. I think it's brilliantly done, and I defy you to find anything that is better made and produced.
Stunning to look at. The lighting, congratulations to everyone behind the scenes, we should say as well. Really incredible. Vigil. Oh, so good. So I've only seen episode one.
Oh, I've seen three, because they had three streaming this week.
Oh.
No, it's a corker. I mean, I do think it's lost some of its uniqueness.
I love the submarine.
Because of the submarine, which was terrific. So this has become more of a kind of ordinary thriller now. However, Suran Jones is magnificent. Romola Garai is extraordinary.
She was on our show last week. Well, she was fantastic.
The way that the certainty drains from her face as she discovers that all these people she thought were one thing are something else. I won't say too much,
no,
so
don't
want to ruin the plot for her people. But is it a great performance again. Do Gray Scott, who's also brilliant in the Irvine Welsh Crime on ITVX, which I'd highly recommend as well. Very different performance in that. But here he's a sort of absolutely, convinced, fairly high ranking, I think he's an air marshal. And then Rose Leslie, although goodness me, I was really worrying about Rose. She was throwing herself off things.
Is she actually pregnant?
I think,
in real life?
I looked it up and it seems to tally with her because she's just had a second child.
Oh.
So I was just wincing my way through it. I hope she wasn't pregnant, but anyway, you do sort of think, oh, please, can you just, because everybody keeps saying to her, you've got to calm down.
Yes,
and
calm
I'm going,
down.
Yes, you have. Calm down. But it's a corking good watch. And I think it's great seeing all these really strong female actors holding their own. Yes, ably supported by some fantastic English male actors as well.
Absolutely.
And a wonderful Gary Lewis, who was the dad from Billy Elliot, makes a wonderful sort of boss, rather sort of sweet-natured boss. Again, it's all against type. It's very refreshing. Nobody's who you think they're going to be, and it's not predictable.
It's very interesting. A lot of people didn't like it. They said, oh, I watched the first half hour and I just couldn't. You know what? Stick with it, because after the first half hour, goodness me, things happen.
They really do. Oh, it belts along.
It really does. And let's end this part before music with The Crown. Again, congratulations to everybody. I've actually watched the finale.
Ah,
I cried.
You're further on than me.
I cried.
I've only watched the first one. And I do think some of the casting's a bit weird. I think the actors are far too old. They should have stuck with the younger ones because they're supposed to be 11 and 14 or something, and they're clearly men in their 20s. So that's a bit silly. And I thought the scene with Prince Philip showing this extraordinary emotional intelligence when they're famously a family who are unable to express their emotions, I thought they missed a trick there. It would have been a more interesting thing to see people who were trying to help each other in grief but failing because of upbringing and class and all that kind of thing. Having said all that, I will be there to the bitter end because I think it's a fascinating insight into something that has meant a great deal to a lot of people. I'm a Republican, as you know, but I still find it fascinating.
But interestingly, though, we obviously don't know the private conversations, and I found some of it a little intrusive between Dodi and Diana. We don't know about those conversations.
No, I mean, a lot of it now is imagined, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's weird. I think we had this conversation before. As it's come up to modern times, it's taken on a much more soap opera feel because their lives were more revealed. They became soap opera stars, whether they liked it or not.
Yes.
When Claire Foy is the Queen, nobody really knows.
We didn't know her. That, yeah.
And it's all about being restrained. And of course, she was magnificent, I think. Possibly the best queen for me, but she probably had the better drama.
I have
drama.
To say, I agree with you. And then you wait to the finale and Imelda Staunton, I will cry.
Yeah, she's a great actress.
The finale is something, it's incredibly moving because they talk about, and I'm not giving anything away.
Okay.
They
well,
talk
no,
about
quite.
The funeral.
We know how it ends.
So they talk about, the queen talked about her funeral and the queen sadly died during the making of this.
Right.
It is utterly, I mean, it really is. I was weeping. There's something very special and emotional that happens at the end.
Oh, right. Well, I will. Don't tell me.
Beautifully done. The very, very last five minutes are exceptional.
Well, I mean, I think it has been a great series throughout the generations. But for me, the Claire Foy years probably were the most sort of enduring and also possibly the most subtle. But I do think that is because it was an age of restraint, whereas now we're in a different age, which is the age of soap opera, and perhaps not quite as satisfying.
It feels very fitting to play the next song, considering I was just saying how emotional I felt about it. More from Sinead William straight after Whitney.
Always knew I would feel that magic fall.
Down finale. We're here with Sean Ed William. You're listening to me, Gaby Roslin, here on BBC Radio London. If you're listening on BBC Sounds, hello, good afternoon to you. Or you might be listening somewhere in the world and it's still morning. Sean Ed, they listen around the world.
They let us know, which is lovely.
Okay, so we're talking things to look forward to this coming week in the build-up to the big day. Christmas University Challenge. Does that mean they all wear Christmas hats?
Oh, I don't know. Maybe Amel wears a Christmas hat. Who knows? It's a really lovely tradition, this. So they get alumni from universities to come back and perform. And I think the questions are slightly easier for older brains because I don't think people go, you know, quite so quickly to the buzzer. It's hugely entertaining, though, because as a viewer, you're more able to answer these questions than perhaps the real one. And I've been really sort of dwelling on, because I'm a big fan of the real one, and wondering whether I would like Amal Rajan because he's so different to Jeremy Paxman. But it's really interesting because he's very empathetic in a way. I mean, I loved Jeremy Paxman, don't get me wrong, but it is a very different beast with Amal Rajan because he seems to genuinely love having the students there. And he chats away to them. It's a lot less formal. And there's something very lovely about it because it's quite frightening.
Actually, I think he brings a warmth to it.
He does.
But I hope it stays because am I right in thinking they've just cancelled Question of Sport?
Well, I have read that.
Yeah. And I hope that they don't cancel all of, you know, you look.
I doubt it. I mean, University Challenge is such an institution.
But what's a Question of Sport?
Well, I suppose so, but it's a sport programme in a sense. I suppose you could then say, well, perhaps we need a new format for sport. Well, I don't know. I mean, it's a good point, but I mean, I would hope not.
They'll keep University Challenge.
Yeah, it's a great show and it's a great family show. So that's Monday, BBC Two at 8:30. It begins. There's 9 episodes streamed across the next few weeks.
And of course, you can catch everything on iPlayer.
Then we have Hairy Bikers.
Yeah.
Yes, it's so nice. So Dave is back on our screens, having been ill. I think this is going to be quite an emotional programme because he and Cy King, they look at wonderful ingredients for Christmas. It's a Christmas show. You know, we'll learn about how to cook lovely Christmas food. But they're also talking to the people who supported Dave Myers during his illness, friends, surgeons, whatever. And so I think it will be quite touching and moving. But I think also I've seen them talking since Dave's come back, and they've still got all that cheeky, fun, quirky attitude to food and just passion, absolute passion for cooking and for food. So I think this will be a really lovely, warm, but also I always learn something when I watch them, that, you know, you learn something about how to cook, and they're always talking about their mums and lovely sense of tradition, that they're doing the stuff that they learned from their own parents. So there's something very lovely about it. So I think it will be a lovely show.
They're very warm and friendly, which is lovely. Late Night Lycett, good. I'm so pleased it's back. It's Christmas. Channel 4, Thursday, 10 p.m, Joe Lycett.
Yeah.
He's making people think differently.
He really does. He's very astute. He challenges orthodoxies, but he's another one who just makes you feel that anything is possible, really, that it's an inclusive place, this world, that people are welcome whoever they are and whatever they are. But also he's really funny. I've seen him develop. I remember seeing a work in progress years ago in the Machynlleth Comedy Festival when it was just him in a notebook, and I've never seen anyone with so much poise. He just was reading funny things he'd thought about out of his book. One of the most brilliant hours of comedy I've ever seen. And then he grew from that. I saw him in a cabaret bar in Edinburgh, you know, with a fairly small audience. And then the following year, he was in a huge venue, and it was all word of mouth.
You've just said something that's blown my mind, because you have been involved in comedy for many, many years. You were head of comedy in television. You were head of comedy in radio. And you've just said that was the best hour. Wow. Joe Lycett, I know you listened to this. I hope you took that on board.
He's a star.
Sean Ed William, thank you very much indeed. Please, if you can, go nowhere and stick around, because we've got the most amazing lineup of people. So Lenny Henry, I spoke to him just a couple of days ago, so we're going to be playing that out at the end of the show. Josh Dillon, Andrew McLean, Let Loose are going to be playing live. Anthea Turner and her sister Wendy Turner, they'll all be on the show.
This afternoon on the home of London football.
Bowen, wonderful return pass. This is going to be a moment for Arsenal. Here comes Brian Bulmo. Comfortable penalty.
West Ham against Wolves and Brentford versus Aston Villa. Plus Harlequins against Toulouse in the European Champions Cup.
On digital radio, TV and on the BBC Sports app
from 1:30.
BBC Radio London Sport. The home of London football.
Text 81333, starting your message with the word London.
Texts are charged at your standard message rate. See our privacy notice at bbc.co.uk/local-radio-privacy or find us on social media.
BBC.
Radio London.
To be young, love that song. A big Miley Cyrus fan. Coming up later, I'm going to be speaking to Josh Dillon. He's in the Buccaneers on Apple TV Plus, and he was in Mamma Mia 2. And controversial, I know, but I preferred Mamma Mia 2 to Mamma Mia 1. Am I allowed to say that? Well, I just have.
Mm-hmm. peace and harmony. Cause if we can get it together, tell me how happy can we be? Wait a minute, don't forget your mom and papa. I know it's special to you. Tell me what you need now. Try my best to send it to